So the next speaker is diagnostic network performance degradation with robot analytics. Çilgiz Alatilnoglu, Peki Design, please welcome.
Thank you, Evgeny. I'm pleased to be here today and talking to you about robot analytics. Well, this all started with a jitter study that we did back in 2000. Actually, we did four jitter studies and four backbones. Three of them were in the US, I have forgotten one of them, and one was in Europe. What we find out, this was actually, this particular graph that you are seeing at the bottom, was the jitter between Washington DC and San Francisco across 1 week period, and we send about 1 megabit per second traffic and a lot of packets, as you can imagine. And what we find out that 99.99% of the time, network was extremely clean, almost no jitter. That's not to say jitter doesn't exist. Usually it exists in the access and aggregation networks where you have basically oversubscription. You have many users and you want to, you know, they don't always use it, YouTube. Whereas in the core, usually the network is over-provisioned and there's excess bandwidth and queues usually don't form up, because you want to be able to resilient to link failures and so forth. And this is actually showing the jitter in the core of the network across the week, almost 99.99, four nines basically, no jitter. Except when jitter happened, it was very severe. This is back in 2000. Basically, it happened very rarely, but when it happened, it was very severe. You look at it, basically, it's very clear, clean at the beginning, and then there is about 10 seconds of no packets going through, basically packet drops, 10 seconds worth, and then followed by a short duration of packets with extreme jitter, up to like 7 seconds of jitter. We looked at this, we were a little bit puzzled. It cannot be congestion, especially in a network where you typically have no congestion, no jitter, nothing. What was this? So in this graph, actually the time axis on the X is basically the transmission time of the our basically measurement packets. What we did to look at the same graph, but instead of the transmission time, we actually put the reception time of the packets on the X-axis. And then, unfortunately, I have to choose one of these displays and point. So basically packets, Simon. So packets come, these little dots each packets, and you can see the packet one, and this is the transmission time. And you can see basically major reordering is happening. It's very hard to do it with this one. I have to use my hands, I suppose. So basically, this is explained by a routing loop unwinding. There is a routing loop in the network, and then packets come in, they go in the loop, they're gonna loop there until the TTL exceeds and they are dropped, that's the beginning. But as the routing loop unwinds, they'll start to be actually received, and depending on how many times they loop there, they'll have an extreme jitter. And the reordering also is happens, because as the packets are looping, new packets are coming, and they're together, they are looping again. It's hard to describe without having a laser pointer. But anyway, so this is basically a routing loop explains this particular behavior. That was a theory. And then we said, okay, what can we do about this? So we built this system. So we had a test system. We were already sending this traffic for jitter measurement. We added to that some ISIS, all of these networks were running ISIS, some ISIS engine that we ourselves developed. It didn't do much. All it did was to establish an adjacency, send ISIS hello packets. As a result, it looked like a router to the rest of the routers. We started receiving ISIS messages from the routers. And then when we received it, we timestamped it on the host at the Washington DC. When we received it, we also timestamped that particular same message in the test host in San Francisco. But for it to be a routing loop, it has to be a routing loop that lasted more than 10 seconds. And that was also very surprising to us. We weren't really expecting that. But once we get the ISIS data, we were able to tell, yes, this is indeed a routing loop. But you see on the top left graph, if the ISIS activity is very In this particular network, it was very churn. It had a lot of high churn. And then the blue graph underneath is the actual changes. So basically, there is actually indeed topological changes in this network, but because of the refreshes, it's a lot of activity. The graph on the lower right is the propagation delay. So basically, a link fails. And what is the time difference when we hear it in DC versus when we hear it in San Francisco? You can see in this particular network, actually, you can have propagation delays up to hundreds of seconds. This, I have to caution that all of these problems, actually, some of them had to do with the router vendor bugs and so forth. They've all been fixed. I don't mean to scare you with any of this stuff. As a matter of fact, after this, we worked with both two primary router vendors, and all of this got fixed, and today, some of these problems do not happen. But nevertheless, when you have this, your link state databases and your routers are not in sync, and as a result, you are doing an SPF, two routers are doing SPF, and their databases are not in sync, and you can basically create routing loops. So that definitely explains our theory. But what we also find out is that routing is extremely valuable in diagnosing network performance problems, and people started asking. We were presenting these at various operator forums, and the service providers who work within these studies, they started asking about, you know, can we get an access to your set of tools that you were building? We were really building those tools for ourselves. It wasn't really in a shape to be distributed, but we thought, you know what, that can be a great thing to do. So we started working on route analytics back in early 2000s. How does it look like today? It has evolved a lot, obviously. We collect, or any route analytics system, I should say, collects basically first everything from the network, everything in the routing space. Your IGPs, OSPF, ISIS, BGP, all address families, RSPPT tunnels, multicast, and you basically collect this data and you store it. Obviously, a lot of people do that, but what makes it analytics is what you do with that data. You know, you can basically do root cause analysis and how you exit to the internet. You can have a BGP peering traffic analysis, and you can do diagnostics like we did with the jitter study. You can do alerting, all of that. And as in the jitter study, I think the utmost application of route analytics is troubleshooting and visualization. You can look at your network at any given time. For example, a problem may happen this morning and you get to work on it in the afternoon. Problem is no longer in the network, but you have the stored data. You can rewind like a network DVR to the network state, to the morning when the problem was happening, and look at the routing tables, find paths in the network, and so forth. Obviously, you also want to do this in real time as it is happening. For example, if there's a major service that you are providing and that service degrades, you want to be alerted whether a router is doing high churn or you have a critical path in the network and that reroutes, and suddenly instead of traffic from Moscow to St. Petersburg have to go all the way through East Russia, you can be alerted of things like that. That would be the monitoring portion of this. You can use data to assess the health of your network. For example, what is the most critical link or a router if it was to fail, which it would have the worst impact in the network, and so forth. And you can tie this with the flow data, like NetFlow, and you can do basically topology-aware traffic analysis, which is actually very useful for things like BGP peering analysis and so forth. In addition, because everything is driven from the routing messages, you can actually change routing and see what the impact will be. For example, you can take down a router. Let's say you are going to do a maintenance on a router tonight, and you can take it down and see what services will be impacted, what paths will be impacted, and what will the delays be, and so forth. It's very easy to do those kind of what-if-like planning stuff, because everything is driven by routing messages, and you can basically mock up a routing message and then run it through the same engine. It will actually say, oh, this link is now done, even though in reality it's not, and give you a report of that. Next, I'd like to take you through a couple of example uses of this that gives actually more value, I think, and also operationally relevant use cases that makes it easier to understand the value of route analytics. So this was a use case in the US. There was a peering router between two major service providers. And they were doing a routine hardware maintenance. They were swapping a line card. It was supposed to be hot swappable. So you pull it up, you put a new one. Unfortunately, it wasn't quite hard swappable. When they take it out, router crashed. It can happen, you know, it can happen with anybody's. All vendors have sometimes once in a while, you know, these things happen. But what was surprised, these two service providers peered in total of 6 locations. One peering router crashed. So you expect, what do you expect? You would expect that the traffic will be rerouted to other 5 locations. But that's not what happened, actually. All 6 locations, traffic got blackholed. These two service providers were not exchanging traffic anymore. And this lasted about 3 minutes. And because this has to do with the timers and the routing protocols, obviously. It's a 3-minute outage. Obviously, 3-minute outage for it to escalate to the right level of network engineering is not practical. Basically, you cannot escalate it fast enough for someone to have a look at it and diagnose the problem. And after 3 minutes, problem was fixed by itself automatically because routing protocols reconverged. So you have no trace of that. Actually, it had a business effect of a 45 minute because this particular service provider was providing a major instant messaging service, and that had a 45 minute outage because people cannot chat, they go and do something else, they come back. That was a 45 minute and quite a few million dollars worth of loss of revenue for them. And they looked at the logs, they tried all sorts of other things and they couldn't figure out, and they got SEs from the vendors. But actually, meanwhile, the whole time, and there was a route analytics appliance installed in this network, but was used by the BGP peering group, and they have eventually decided to look at that. So this is how the network was before the failure. Basically, they had 6 exit points, and those are circled. And basically, blue routers are using the router and circle, which is colored blue and so forth. Green ones are using the green and so forth. So this is how the network switched between the two ASS at the, before the time of the failure. Then, similar to the graphs that I've shown you with the jitter, the link fails, which is on the top here. It's very hard to aim. The basically router fails, and then when you pull the hot swap, and the two links that connect to the rest of the routers are also become red because, you know, that's no longer part of it. And on the middle graph, you see the ISIS activity, and that the circle through lines basically indicate the ISIS activity that shows you what happened. And when you look at it, basically one router says, I am dropping my neighborship relationship with this other router. And there are 2 core routers connected to, they both do the same thing. By the way, I have renamed, I marked the slide so that those router names are not actual router names. And IP addresses too, I have marked them. They're a little bit different than what they are. So when the router goes down, and this is now a new situation in the network. In addition to the original 6 exit routers, there is actually 6 more exit routers in the network. But these exit routers also circled in the middle. These are actually core routers. They do not have eBGP session to this particular service provider. As a matter of fact, they have no eBGP sessions on them. Why was this happening? Basically, this is the reason why the whole traffic got blackholed, because everybody was taking these core routers as the exit routers. So you can actually look at that by just comparing 2 paths. Here is a path and that took the failed router before the exit on the left. You can see it's from this HDFW03 router to this particular prefix. It's following a BGP prefix, and then that BGP prefix is resolved by an ISIS prefix. After the failure, the graph on the right, it shows the same router thinks has a route, but it ends prematurely before it can go to the exit router because it is this core router. And if you look at why that decision was made, it's still following the same BGP route. As a matter of fact, it's still following the same BGP route announced by this failed router, because I'll explain to why that is happening, but this time, the BGP next stop is resolved by another BGP route, which is the less specific, the slash 19 for this service provider. So basically, instead of the /32 that was this particular router, now it's actually announced, installed by this BGP route. And why do we have that BGP route? Because that's how we announce ourselves to the rest of the network. This is me in my BGP. I have a /19. You can get to my network by using this route. That's the route that actually used to resolve this. So basically, to recap it, when the peering router crashed, IGP routers are withdrawn within a second, actually, I mean sub-seconds, really. Within tens of milliseconds, they will be down. Whereas BGP routes, the router doesn't have a chance to withdraw them because it's crashed. They are in the system, and they will be thrown away by the other routers only after 3 keep-alives. And in this network, that was 3 keep-alives of 60 seconds, basically, about 3 minutes. Actually, the router rebooted with less than that. But now, during this time, during this 3 minutes time, these BGP routes were resolvable, but not with their next up addresses, but the less specific /19 BGP route. And these were announced by the core routers, and core routers are the shortest distance from any other router, because every router in this network is connected to at least one core router. So as a result, they look at it and say, like, oh, this router has this route. Now the distance to it is now actually closer because just one hop away from me. And that's what they did. And as a result, they ended up sending the traffic to the core routers. And core routers said, I have no choice, but I have to drop these packets. And how you fix this? Basically, easiest way to fix this, if you must announce your /19, also put it into ISIS, but give it a metric which is so expensive that the true exit routers metric will be preferred in the network. ISIS route will be preferred over the BGP, so you will not use the BGP one, but the ISIS, now you have an exit router which is the core, very expensive, or the true exit which is one of those other 5 locations, and it will end up preferring the exit routers. The bottom line is basically 3 minutes is too short, and if you have recorded everything that's happening in the network, you can rewind and then you can analyze this. It wasn't the router, I mean, okay, router should not have crashed, but the reason why the traffic was totally black hole, it wasn't really a router vendor issue, it was more of a network design issue, and it's easy to design a network when everything's up, you can optimize it and everything, but when things fail in the network, it is very hard to figure out what will happen because all of these unforeseen consequences can happen. Another use case of this data is BGP peering traffic analysis. And there is two stories to this. If you're a tier one service provider, the BGP peering game is quite different. And this particular set of slides is more for the regional service providers. And in the majority of the regional service providers, actually, majority of the traffic is coming in from the internet as opposed to going out to the internet. Whereas if you're a tier one, it's different. And in this case, basically, if you want to make peering decisions, you need to know basically where is your traffic is coming from, where it enters your network, which neighbor AS sends it to you, and if you have multiple routers that connect, you know, which one of those is carrying the traffic for you. And you need to make decisions, like for example, when these capacity of these links you start to exceed the capacity of these links, you need to either increase the capacity of these links or decide whether you should add new links to new service providers, the same service provider, or perhaps there's opportunities where you can save transit cost. It's all about saving basically transit cost. And what the routing aware traffic flow analysis does, you get the flow record and you know the routing, and you know where that, basically, for example, let's say that we get the flow record on the second hop in this picture, because you know the source address, you know the destination address, you know the IGP and the BGP, you can map the full path of this flow. You can say where it entered, what path it took, where it exit, which exit router it took, which neighbor AS it went, which transit ASs, destination AS, and all of that. And from this, you can actually generate a really, really rich BGP peering analysis reports. For example, here are the top source, traffic by top source ASs. No surprise, Google, Akamai, Netflix, and this is from a US provider, obviously. Otherwise, it would have been mail.ru. And in this case, actually, they have a direct peering relationship with Google, and that's about, this screen is kind of bouncing, but I think it's about 16 to 18 gigabit per second. And that traffic, I don't have to pay for cost. The second entry in this table is from their paid transit provider. Again, I changed the name so that I'm not revealing who they are and so forth. And they are paying significant amount of money to that one, and then rest of the other neighbors that they have. But you need this kind of data to see whether you can cut costs by peering directly. A third report that may be interesting is the transit AS. And for example, you may not be able to peer with the content provider itself because they may be elsewhere, but there may be a network in the middle. If you peer with them, they may be able to pass you that traffic. Getting this requires actually a lot of heuristics because you don't really know who would be behind them. But basically, if you look at the BGP updates during convergence, it reveals a lot of the backdoor paths, and then it can give you an estimate of how much traffic you can get if you just peer somebody in the middle. I talked about modeling a little bit earlier, and then let's say you decide to peer with one of the ASs, whether that would work it or not. You can also basically plan that using the route analytics framework. You can say, I'm going to peer in this location, this will be the AS number. Then we find all the BGP routes that AS is announcing to you. I mean, it may not be announcing to you directly, but at least in the AS path it's mentioned, and during this convergence, all the other routes that it is behind it, and find all the traffic, and then estimate how much traffic might be entering in this new location if you did that. And once you did that, you know you have the current traffic values now. You have the current values rerouted. You can see whether you have saved any transit or not. Unfortunately, this particular graph is from our lab, so there isn't any savings because there isn't that much traffic anyway. But yeah, this report would have actually show you how much traffic you are transiting before and after, and then the difference. I have 2 minutes left, and I think I'll have to do this slide and then probably skip a few slides. So basically, route analytics also simplifies planning because everything works on the model of the model of routing. It's not based on simulation or emulation or anything. And basically, it all works on BGP routes, and if you did a new, if you added a new peering, that can be modeled very easily because it's very easy to find, you create BGP routes. You basically mock up a set of BGP routes and insert it into the analytics, and it will think you actually have, as if it learned it from the network, there's a new peering there. It will say, okay, let me reroute all these flows as if they come from there, and then give you an idea of the impact of that. And I was going to talk about a little bit of the SDNs, but I think I'm going to skip that in the interest of time. So basically, in conclusion, routing definitely impacts the performance, and we have seen it, I mean, in the worst case, it makes things unreachable. That's obviously the worst performance you can ever get, but it can lead to suboptimal paths. You can have long delays, high jitters, and all of that. And having an ability to record everything that's happening in the network is extremely powerful. It's useful for troubleshooting, monitoring, alerting, and so forth. Questions?
Small question. The first case with black hole, how did you collect statistic? Is it some kind of network device or network probe that have a BGP assertions and takes part in the ISIS topology and dumps the information each few seconds, or how did you collect all the information to make detailed investigation of the first case?
Yeah, a good question actually. What we did is there's an appliance, is physically connected to the routers, usually in the same rack as the routers, and it's very hardened appliance obviously. And then for ISIS, we send the hello packet, and router sends the hello packet, the adjacency is established. Then on every single ISIS update, we receive just like another router in the network. When we receive it, we timestamp it, we put it to a database, every single detail about it. Same thing with the BGP. We open a session, create a route reflector or to exit routers, you know, or combination, whatever. And anytime there is an update in the BGP, we receive a packet just like any other router. But we do not do like every 3 seconds to a dump or something like that. We write every single message. Obviously, database structure of the database is very challenging because you want to be able to have a fast movement across the data and so forth. So we have periodic snapshots of the data that to make it faster for us, but that's an internal. The important part is that we have every single update. So we can give you to your network state at any millisecond of the day, not just any second of the day.